بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم حامدا ومصليا وبعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. In today's lesson on Balaagha, we're going to cover a new chapter in علم المعاني on the topic of Ejaz and Itnab, or brevity and verbosity. Ejaz, or brevity, is to express your thoughts in a relatively brief way, or concise way, or succinct way. Of course, without compromising any of the meaning. You don't just take away words at random, of course. For example, Allah Azza wa Jal starts Surah Mursalat with the ayah وَالْمُرْسَلَاتِ عُرْفَى. Now here we have basically just three words, or you could count it as about a dozen vocalized sounds. So this is a very short statement. But the meaning behind this is the statement is incredibly profound, and the books of Tafsir talk about this verse at length. Just to give you an idea, the word Mursalat means those that have been let loose or let go. The word is feminine plural, and the type of plurality suggests that the number of things that have been let loose are relatively few in number, between 3 and 10. Now the word orfan, in this context, refers to the hair on an animal's neck, especially a horse. From the context of the surah, we know Allah Azza wa Jalla is talking about the wind, because you know the very next verse verses make this quite clear. But the words Allah uses are in complete harmony with how the Arabs describe horses, especially strong, fast, racing horses. So think about a wild horse. When you're on the back of a wild horse, which I don't recommend by the way, the horse is extremely violent, and it has the potential to wreak a lot of havoc. And in the absence of reins, what you have to do in order to maintain control is to pull back on its neck hair, or the urf. This keeps the horse at bay, at least a little bit. Now what if you let go of this hair? This wild horse obviously is going to go crazy. It's going to run wild and it's going to destroy everything in its path. And it turns out that the wind is exactly the same way. Allah is holding onto the urf of the winds as if they're a set of wild stallions. Because of Allah's restraints on the winds, we derive a lot of benefit from them. But if Allah were to let those same winds loose on us, they would destroy everything in sight, as we see with hurricanes and tornadoes. So in just three short words, Allah Azza wa Jal made an incredible analogy and a metaphor that took me minutes to explain, and I didn't even do it justice. This is brevity, or concision, or succinctness. In Arabic, it's called Ijaz. Itnab, or verbosity, is to express your thoughts in a relatively verbose or lengthy way. You know, you use more than the average number of words and sentences, more than expected. Of course, without being redundant or, how shall I say this, like boring. You know, the extra words that you add have to have some purpose behind them. The famous example of this in the Quran is where Allah Azza wa Jal asks Musa alayhi salam what he's holding in his right hand. Now, the straightforward answer would have been, my staff. But Musa alayhi salam decided to prolong the conversation and he answered, hiya asaya, it's my staff. أتوكأ عليها, I lean on it, وأهش بها على غنمي, and I shake the leaves down for my flock, وَلِيَ فِيهَا مَآرِبُ أُخْرَى, and I derive a lot of other benefit from it. So here Musa alayhi salam is using more than the average or expected number of words and sentences to say this simple answer. So we say that he's exercising verbosity, or itnab. And finally, musawat is to express your thoughts using an average number of words and sentences, or the expected number of words and sentences. So it's the balance in between Ijaz and Itnab. All three of these methods are acceptable in Balaagha, and they each have their benefits. Sometimes Ijaz is appropriate, sometimes Itnab is appropriate, and sometimes Musawat is appropriate. There are some methods, however, that are not acceptable in Balaagha. Ikhlal, for example, is where you try to be brief. So you're trying to use Ijaz, but in doing so, you compromise the meaning. You know, a word is missing, so meaning is missing. As another example, Hashu is where you try to be verbose, so you're trying to exercise Itnab, but you add words that are redundant. They're not adding any benefit at any level. And Tatwil is kind of like Hashu, so you're trying to use Itnab, you're trying to be verbose, but your extra words and sentences don't have any meaning. But it's a little bit different from Hashu. Hashu and Tatwil are related. Hashu is where you can tell which word is extra, so you can just take it away, and then it'll become Musawat. But Tatwil, it's just you're The spirit of tatwil is basically where you write in, you know how you write an essay that was supposed to be 500 words, but your essay ends up being 1,000 words? Now you can't just start removing words and sentences and paragraphs. You basically have to rewrite it. That's kind of the spirit of tatwil. And of course, all three of these, ikhlal, hashu, and tatwil, are all unacceptable in balagha, and you won't find a single example from the Quran. In our next lesson, inshallah, we'll dig a little bit deeper into the types of ijaz and itnab, and we'll look at some interesting examples from the Quran, inshallah.